Hello everyone in YouTube land watching the video. This is, as I always like to remind you, an audio podcast, and this is just the behind scenes video of me recording the audio podcast, the Airline Pilot Guy show. And if you'd like to listen to the audio only, take me with you in your car, in your airplane, on your bike, on your run, on your walk, whatever. You can find me on iTunes. I'm the Airline Pilot Guy. Head over to airlinepilotguy.com, and there you will see the many different ways that you can listen to me and also watch me on YouTube as you're doing right now. For full show notes of this episode, go to airlinepilotguy.com/120. And there you'll find the entry for this particular episode. So sit back and relax. Enjoy the show. All right, here we go. Staff, are you ready? I don't have a staff. Okay. Airline Pilot Guy, episode 120. Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, the view from my side of the cockpit door. I'm Captain Jeff, your host, broadcasting live from Studio 601 in the Sheraton Galleria Hotel in Addison, Texas. In this episode, well, we're going to talk about an incident with a new Dreamliner, Japan Airlines Dreamliner, heading into Tampa International Airport for the first time. A little oopsie there. Let's see, pilots swallowing drugs, little incident of some dog poo causing a divert, lots more news, and of course your feedback. So sit back and relax, tray tables and seat backs in their upright and locked positions, electronic devices powered on, flight 120 is ready for pushback. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Airline Pilot Guy Show. If you're just joining us, the Airline Pilot Guy community, for the first time, let me introduce myself. I'm Captain Jeff. I'm an airline pilot, hence the name of the show, Airline Pilot Guy. I'm a line captain for a major U.S. legacy air carrier, and I've been doing that now for a little bit more than 25 years. Before that, I was in the United States Air Force, and I flew the C-141 Starlifter, and I was an instructor pilot on the T-37. And there you have it. That's me. I do the show because I love aviation, and this is my way of kind of giving back to all the great stuff that's happened to me in my flying career. And so hopefully I'm here to answer your question. If you'd like to ask a question, you can send it to feedback@airlinepilotguy.com or head over to the airlinepilotguy.com website, and then you'll see various ways to send me feedback. So I guess you could kind of think of me as the airline pilot answer man. There you go. Okay. Well, I'm here in Addison, Texas at the Sheraton Galleria Hotel, not too far away from the Galleria. And it's a beautiful day here in Dallas. I'm positioned in front of my window here, looking out through the sheer curtains, and I can tell that the sky is a nice blue with a couple white puffy clouds in it. So really nice day here. A little warm, but, you know, this is Texas, and it's June. So what do you expect, right? Day two of a four-day trip, and let's see, we... So far on this trip, flew from Atlanta to Memphis, and then back to Atlanta, and then ended up in at Bradley International again, Springfield, Massachusetts. A shorter layover, not a hugely long layover there. And then this morning, flew out early from Bradley International to Detroit, and then here to Dallas-Fort Worth. You can tell that my throat, or my voice, is a little bit different. And yes, I've been hit again by allergies. I don't know what the pollen is up there in the Northeast, but it kind of nailed me last week, and I'm still suffering the after effects from a little bit of post-nasal drip, and it's in my lungs, it's in my throat, it's just, I'm a mess. So, but instead of delaying the show or not doing an episode this week, I thought the show must go on. The other thing is that I really should be studying right now for my recurrent training, my simulator training, which I have coming up on Friday. I get home from the trip on Thursday, and then Friday night and Saturday night I will be at the training complex at ACME headquarters doing my recurrent training, which now is every 9 months. It used to be every year, but for some reason now we're doing a nine-month cycle. So I think we should get on with the show so that I can get finished with this. And oh, before I do that, I need to let you know that I'm planning a meetup in Cleveland tomorrow, Cleveland, Ohio, and PJ Gustafson. Why do I have trouble pronouncing your name, PJ? I don't get it. Gustafson. There we go. And Paul are two airline pilot guy community members that are going to be meeting up with me, and perhaps you, if you're. Of course, by the time you hear this, it's already late because this should be issued on Friday, and the meetup is occurring on Wednesday. So, but I did put out, if you're interested in finding out about meetups, I did put out a newsletter, an email to the email list for those who subscribe to that. And if you're ever in the area and I plan on a meetup, I'll just send that out, and hopefully I'll target it to just people in that area. That's my plan. But I sent out my first MailChimp email blast, and I sent it to everybody on the list because, honestly, I didn't have time, and I was tired, to figure out exactly how to target it to just a narrow portion of the people on the list. But anyway, so I hope to see you in Cleveland tomorrow, and if not, maybe in your town or near where you live in the future some other time. Oh, the sun's really starting to shine in on me here. Pretty bright, but that's good. Sun is bright. Blue sky is good. Okay, and let's see, what else? Okay. I received a tweet from Guy McKenzie, and he says, oh, and regarding the Gatwick Monarch police issue, Ibiza is pronounced Ibiza. And then he put a smiley face, and I'm thinking, Ibiza? Okay, I'm thinking, well, maybe that Spanish island is kind of part of the old Catalonia, and I know that the Catalonian Spanish people kind of speak with a different kind of a pronunciation or accent. And so I did a little research, and I thought, really? That's the way you pronounce it? And so let me see what I found here online.
Ibiza, or Ibiza or Ibiza.
Okay, let's hear that again. This is from howjsay.com.
Ibiza or Ibiza.
Ibiza or Ibiza.
Ibiza or Ibiza.
Or Ibiza. Huh. Okay. There you go. Who knew? Thank you very much. Let me get back to my notes. Thank you very much, Guy McKenzie, for straightening that out. Okay. Let's see, what else before we move on? Anything else? Any more administrative stuff? I don't think so. So let me go over here to my soundboard and play this.
Johnny, how much more coffee?
No, thanks.
And I'm not going to try to sing today because my voice is just not in shape for singing. Okay, the Coffee Fund. That's why I play the Java Jive from the Ink Spots, recorded in 1940, and as far as I'm concerned, is music in the public domain. And since our last show, PayPal, the Airline Pilot Guy Coffee Fund Classic Method. We have David and Woodrow. Thank you, both of you, for your generous contribution. And also, since the last show, patreon.com site for Airline Pilot Guy, if you want to become a patron and give me a tip or a certain amount of money per episode for content produced, you can join DJ and everybody else over there. Thank you, DJ. He joined us as a regular contributor via patreon.com. So if you're wondering about what the coffee fund is all about, it's just your way of helping me out with offsetting some of the costs of doing this show. And I do appreciate each and every single one of you for your kind contributions. I'm not gonna wanna be unless it is the cheery, cheery bean boy. Okay. I'm going to turn that down, and now it is time to move on to the news. All right, the first thing that I have on the list of things I wanted to talk about, and well, you know what? Before I do this, let me talk about this. I think it was Dr. Steph, Mike Cochran in outside of Orlando, and I think Robert or Richard, and several others sent me links to this article or episode. Twitter was abuzz Wednesday with pictures and complaints after a dog pooed in the middle of a Philadelphia-bound flight, forcing an emergency landing. Smell bad. Dog poop forced an emergency landing, according to passengers aboard a U.S. Airways flight 598 from Los Angeles to Philadelphia. Now, those passengers took to Twitter to document the smelly ordeal. Passengers said that a large dog went to the bathroom in the plane's aisle as many as three times, making people nearby physically ill. The second time, after the dog pooped, they ran out of paper towels. They didn't have anything else. The pilot comes on the radio, quote, "Hey, we have a situation in the back. We're going to have to emergency land." The plane was diverted to Kansas City, Missouri, where a cleaning crew, lucky cleaning crew, huh? Cleaned up the mess, or the messes, before eventually making its way to Philadelphia. The emergency landing wasn't the only headache for those travelers. Before takeoff, Flight 598 was delayed on the tarmac at LAX for 2 hours for fuel problems. Oh boy, that was, you know, that whole thing just stinks. excuse me. All right. This is something that kind of reminds me of an incident that I was involved in a couple of years ago. Kind of brought back memories of that. A Lufthansa Airbus A380-800 operating flight 462 from Frankfurt, Germany to Miami, Florida, with 427 people on board. Wow, a lot of people. Was descending towards Miami when the crew stopped the descent at 9,000 feet due to weather conditions and entered a hold. About 20 minutes holding, the crew decided to divert to Orlando, Florida, climbed to flight level 220, but aborted the flight to Orlando, turned around, and decided to divert to Fort Lauderdale, but again, needed to decide to abort the approach to Fort Lauderdale due to weather, declaring emergency because of being low on fuel. The crew decided to land in Miami as the weather had improved sufficiently in Miami. Upon checking in with Miami approach, the crew advised that they had 5.2 tons of fuel remaining. That's about 10,400 pounds. The aircraft was vectored for an ILS approach to runway 27. They went through a wind shear, loss of 15 knots, about 2 nautical miles before touchdown, became visual at 400 feet AGL, and landed safely on runway 27 at 3:26 local time in the afternoon, after 75 minutes after stopping the first descent at 9,000 feet, and about 13 minutes after reporting 10,400 tons of fuel remaining. The aircraft was instructed to roll to the end of the runway, vacate the runway there, and follow the follow-me vehicle awaiting the aircraft there. Sources told the Aviation Herald that the aircraft touched down with 3 tons of fuel remaining, which was below the required final fuel reserve. And folks, that's only 6,000 pounds of fuel. And I can tell you what, the airplane that I fly, the MD-88, MD-90 series, hold approximately 150, 160 passengers, much, much smaller than that Airbus 380. When I get down to 6,000 pounds, you know, that's a typical weight that we land with, sometimes a little bit below that. But when it starts getting down there below 6,000 pounds, I'm starting to not get nervous, but I'm starting to really pay attention, if you know what I mean. So, in an airplane with 4 engines, that big, with only 6,000 pounds of fuel remaining, that is definitely emergency fuel. And I'm sure that they were feeling the pressure. There are some METARs listed on the Aviation Herald entry about this incident. And let me tell you what, the weather that day, I believe this was May 15th of this year, was not good. The weather goes from anywhere from light thunder showers, heavy thunder showers, thunderstorms, heavy rain, even tornadoes. A couple different tornadoes were sighted and observed touching down to the west of the airport. So it was not a beautiful day in southern Florida, for sure. And again, it reminds me of a time, and I know that the first officer that was with me is listening to the show, I'm sure. And I'm sure that he'll remember as well. We were coming down from, I think, LaGuardia or John F. Kennedy, one of the New York airports, down to Fort Lauderdale. And we got down there, and it was one of those systems that, you know, this time of year, these systems can just kind of pop up like, you know, really, really quickly in South Florida. And a line of these storms just kind of billowed up and basically shut down all of the airports, all the way from south of Miami, all the way up through Melbourne, almost Melbourne. And we were holding at one point over Freeport, I believe, and then they moved us down to Bimini, and nobody was getting in. The air traffic controllers, Miami Center, were saying that all the airports were closed. We were communicating with our dispatcher, and he said that, well, they're not closed. You know, we're not showing anything that shows these airports closed. And so we're getting conflicting information. The fuel's getting lower and lower, and we do the calculations and determine it looks like we're going to be minimum fuel. So we made the decision to head up north to Melbourne, Florida. And then as we're doing that, we hear Miami Center offer to somebody else out there who is not in a critical fuel state as we were to give it a try to go into Fort Lauderdale. And I went, hey, what about us? We're like emergency fuel now. Because we calculated by the time we arrived in Melbourne, we were going to be at the emergency fuel level. And he said, okay, yeah, you want to give that a try? I went, yeah. So we made it into Fort Lauderdale between a couple different thunderstorm cells and landed safely. So I'll tell you what, that is not a good feeling when you're out there flying around and you're watching the fuel level drop lower and lower and lower, and all of your options are narrowing to the point where you really start feeling a lot of stress. And that was definitely one of those situations for myself and my first officer. So anyway, happy ending to that story. Not so happy ending for a Japan Airlines Dreamliner who was arriving at the Tampa International Airport for the first time. And a lot of times, fire trucks will come out to greet flights that are like the first flight from a certain origin, or the first time a certain type of airplane has come into an airport. And so to kind of celebrate that. A lot of times they'll position the fire trucks on either side of the airplane, and they'll shoot water over the top, like in a cascading arc. And there's video on YouTube that shows the Japan Airlines 787 getting a wee bit too close with its right wingtip to the fire truck that was apparently mispositioned, a little bit too close to the airplane. And the right wingtip of this brand new Dreamliner clipped the fire truck's water spout, or whatever you call that thing, and did some damage to the wingtip. That's a big oopsie. Sad news. You may have heard about this Gulfstream 4 that crashed at Hanscom Field in Bedford, Massachusetts this past Saturday night. Here's a little bit of audio.
Gulfstream 1, Julia Mike, you on? Gulfstream 1, Julia Mike Tower. Hanscom 3 on? Anyone on?
Yeah, the airplane crashed on its takeoff roll on early Sunday morning, actually, 2:30 a.m. Nobody on board the airplane survived. Seven people died in the incident, including the co-owner of the Philadelphia Inquirer, Lewis Katz. He was among the seven dead. So sad to hear about that. I haven't been able to get any information at all regarding what could possibly have happened there. There are some eyewitnesses that say that they thought the airplane was on fire before it crashed, but as many of you know who are accident investigators, probably not a lot of accident investigators out there, but witness reports aren't always that reliable when it comes to these kind of things. They typically see things on fire or exploding when they actually are not on fire or are not exploding. Chances are what they saw was the airplane already crashing and catching on fire and exploding. So I don't know if it was a high-speed abort situation or what happened there. So hopefully we'll learn more about that incident soon. This is crazy. A licensed commercial pilot accused of swallowing 62 pellets of cocaine before boarding a flight from Bogota to Houston has been freed from federal custody. Stanley Raphael Hill, 49 years old, of McKinney, Texas, also faces charges in the 185th State District Court, where he was scheduled to appear Friday. There's a video of this guy lunging at a TV news photographer and then ran away as a reporter chased after him. According to federal court records, he arrived May 23rd at George W. Bush Intercontinental Airport on United Airlines Flight 1008 from Bogota, Colombia. Although not on duty as a crew member, he was wearing his pilot's uniform, and he passed through the Federal Inspection Service and U.S. Customs and Border Protection without incident and checked in at a hotel near the airport at the 6100 block of Will Clayton Parkway. The next morning, he called 911 from his hotel room with a medical emergency and was taken by ambulance to the hospital. At the hospital, he began to pass pellets that later field tested positive for cocaine. On May 25th, the Houston Police Department received an anonymous call stating that drug evidence was being flushed down the toilet, and two officers were sent to investigate. Hill told the officers that he had purchased 250 grams, about 9 ounces, of cocaine for $750 in Bogota and intended to smuggle it into the United States to sell it at a profit. He said he put the cocaine in 62 pellets he made from the fingers of rubber gloves and swallowed them. Oh, that's pretty amazing. The Houston Police Department officers took custody of 18 pellets weighing 148 grams, but the whereabouts of the other 44 packets is unknown.
Brilliant!
Brilliant. So I guess he is a United Express pilot. Did it say in here? I think that, anyway, I think it's one of the, I don't know if he's a United Airlines pilot or a regional airline affiliated with United. Regardless, a stupid move by this particular pilot. Let's see, another, you know, last episode and the episode before that, we talked a lot about near misses. Well, I think we almost had another one. You may not have heard about this one.
Fletcher Delta 312 checking in out of 2600 for 4000.
Delta 23, Christian 312, action cam, the departure radar contact, climb and maintain at 8000, turn left direct near Cumberstone.
Delta 312, climb at 8000 and direct to where, sir?
Charlie Tango with you, first 600, route out of turn traffic, 1 o'clock, 6 miles southbound, Cessna 210, 5000.
Delta 312, we're proceeding direct Charlie Tango with you, looking for the traffic.
November 5, Mike Charlie, traffic 5 miles north of your position, turning southeastbound, is a MD, Christian, a Boeing 717, climbing out of 4,400 for 8,000. We'll be passing behind you.
245, Mike Charlie, negative contact, research.
Delta 312, on your rollout, it'll be a 1 o'clock, 5 miles southbound, 5,000.
Delta 312, roger that. He looks like, on our fish finder, he looks like he's directly in front of us at 4 miles at our altitude.
Right, you're direct newcomers down, correct?
Affirmative, we're direct Charlie Tango Whiskey, heading 188.
Delta 312, roger, turn left heading 140.
Left turn 140, Delta 312.
Number 5, Mike Charlie, I believe we got the MD-80 inside, looks like he's climbing out of the spine.
Affirmative, Delta 312, traffic no factor now, passing off your 3 o'clock in 2 miles. Thanks for the assistance, you can contact Cleveland Center, 120.6 on course.
1206, is that the frequency?
Affirmative, sir.
Delta 312. Sir, that was very uncomfortable. You had us climbing right into that guy. He was like 400 or 500 feet above us, 5 miles ahead, and we were going directly at him. Have a nice day.
Roger. See you.
Okay, so he wasn't very happy, and I don't believe he should have been that happy about that incident. Luckily, they saw the traffic. He said the fish finder, that's what we sometimes refer to, the traffic collision avoidance system display, the TCAS display, if we have it on our navigation display or our radar screen, when we can see the other traffic as potential threats and our resolution advisories as well. Our primary TCAS instrument is our vertical velocity indicator, TCAS display, that gives us a fly to or do not fly to regions on our vertical speed indicator. But so he saw the traffic on there. And he's going, he questioned it, saying, this can't be right. The traffic's only 4 miles ahead, and he's at our altitude, and we're heading right at him. What's going on here? And apparently the controller took the cue and turned him 40 to 50 degrees to the left to avoid the traffic and missed him by a couple of miles. But too close for comfort, I'd say. And by the way, one of our airline pilot guy friends met up with him, Dave Sterling, who also has a podcast, he wrote to me just a few days ago saying that he was flying from Akron, Canton to Atlanta and was wondering if I was flying that day, and I said no. I believe he was flying on a flight a little bit later that day. This is not your flight, Dave, if you're wondering. I believe this one left a little bit before noon or right around midday. Anyway, just thought it'd be interesting to play that for you. And I don't know what's going on out there. It just seems that we're hearing about more and more of these near misses, near collisions. Is automation kind of catching up with the air traffic control world as well? You know, everything is supposed to be taking care of itself with the automation, and people just aren't paying as close attention as they should be. I don't know. If you're an air traffic controller out there, I know I have a few of you who listen to the show, or at least we did have some listening. I'd like to hear your feelings, your comments about that. It'd be interesting to hear that. Okay, and then finally, of course, our update, our weekly update on the Malaysia Flight 370 disappearance. And the latest that I could find, scientists examined sounds suggesting a new location for the missing Flight 370, as a British woman reports seeing burning a burning plane above the Indian Ocean. Royal Australian, no, this is the caption for the picture, never mind. Scientists are investigating a mysterious low-frequency underwater noise detected off the southern tip of India at about the time the missing Malaysia Airlines plane had its last satellite transmission and disappeared. The noise, outside the range of human hearing, reportedly traveled across the Indian Ocean and was picked up by receivers off the west coast of Australia. But its original location, about 3,000 miles northwest of Australia, would not be consistent with the current search area off the Australian coast, which is based on analysis of satellite data by British firm Inmarsat. Alec Duncan, a marine scientist at Curtin University near Perth, said he believed that the chances of the sound being from the missing 777 were about 25 to 30%. It's not even really a thump sort of sound. It's more of a dull oomph, Dr. Duncan told the New York Times. If you ask me what's the probability this is related to the flight, without the satellite data, it's 25 or 30%. But that's certainly worth taking a very close look at. The noise was picked up by a receiver operated off the coast of Perth by Dr. Duncan, used mainly for monitoring whales, and another about 220 miles south of Perth by the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty Organization in Vienna. The scientists have established the direction in which the sound was traveling, but not the distance it traveled, leaving a potential search area spanning more than 200,000 square miles. Mark Pryor, an acoustics expert at the Test Ban Organization headquarters, told the New York Times the sound was consistent with an ocean impact or with a sealed, air-filled container sinking until it crumpled due to the water pressure. So that's interesting. And then adding to the uncertainty surrounding the plane's possible final location, a British woman sailing with her husband across the Indian Ocean from India to Thailand has claimed she may have seen the plane on fire. Catherine T., 41 years old, was on night watch on March 7th through the 8th, but said she did not report the sighting until Sunday because she was having marital problems and thought she was losing her mind. She said recent media reports about the ailing search prompted her and her husband Mark to examine the GPS logs, and they discovered they were within the plane's projected flight path. I looked back through our GPS logs, and lo and behold, what we saw was consistent with the confirmed contact with the authorities, which the authorities had from MH370. Let's see. She said that she saw other planes nearby and thought that they would have reported the burning plane. Here's a quote from Catherine T. I saw something that looked like a plane on fire, she said. Then I thought, I must be mad. It caught my attention because I'd never seen a plane with orange lights before, so I wondered what they were. It looked longer than planes usually do. There was what appeared to be black smoke behind it. There were two other planes well above it, moving the other way at the time. They had normal navigation lights. I remember thinking that if it was a plane on fire that I was seeing, that the other aircraft would report it. So there you go. Some more data points, some more fuel to add to the fire of the disappearance of Malaysia Flight 370. All right, that will do it for today's, or this episode's news. It is time now to move on to your feedback.
Captain, incoming message.
Thank you. All right, let's start with Low Time Larry. And he sent me a very, actually, this was on the website, airlinepilotguy.com. And if you want to look at the comments that people are making on the website, head over there, airlinepilotguy.com. And anyway, he left a very long comment, and I'll read most of it, Larry, but I'm not going to read all of it. It's just quite long, as you actually say in your missive. And but you make some good points here. He says, "Hi, Captain Jeff. It's Low Time Larry. In what is now beautiful weather near MSP, what you experienced experienced in Milwaukee is what we went through all winter and spring, 10 to 20 degrees below normal. Yuck. But we've had some great weather this past week, and it looks like it will continue, at least temperature-wise. He wanted to touch on two subjects from Airline Pilot Guy episode 118. First, the former Prime Minister of Malaysia who blew the lid off the secret uninterruptible autopilot that is installed by Boeing on the aircraft and controlled by the CIA. I'm sure it's part of the same assembly that controls the chemtrail generators in the wings, disguised as the 27th stage compressor muffler bearing. And of course, I expected you to deny its existence. After all, the CIA pays captains $1 million a year to keep quiet and gives first officers a $25 Starbucks gift card. That's why you love your job so much. Shh, Larry, don't tell everybody. Anyway, back on planet Earth, or maybe just low Earth orbit, I read the harrowing account of Mr. Kevin Townsend, where he almost died when his 213-seat 757-300 unexpectedly morphed into a 289-seat 777-200 plus six crew. His narrative needed 295 people on each plane to make it the worst aviation accident in history, surpassing the 583 victims at Tenerife. The Wikipedia page on 757-300 says it has a max certified capacity of 289 passengers. Maybe he assumes that all airliners of a given type had the same cabin layout. Or maybe he was looking for the biggest number that supported his headline. Could be. Okay, so he talks a little bit more about that incident. And he said that he figures that it was U.S. Air Flight 692. He says Cactus 692. That's a great call sign. But I think the best of all is Speedbird. Those Brits really have a way with the language, don't they? Anyway, Cactus. By the way, Cactus, the call sign that U.S. Airways uses, is because before they merged, well, they did merge with America West, and America West Airlines' call sign was Cactus. U.S. Airways' call sign was U.S. Airways. And but because of the merger, they kept the U.S. Airways name for the airline, but they kept the call sign Cactus. And Speedbird is British Airways. And I think that, I'm not sure, but I think that Speedbird has something to do with the fact that they were flying the Concorde. I could be wrong about that. Maybe they had that before the Concorde came online. I don't know. Anyway, so he thinks that the other airplane that the United flight was trying to avoid was possibly Cactus 663. And he's thinking that maybe they saw it and didn't realize how far they were, and maybe they overreacted a little bit, perhaps not getting a resolution advisory. I don't know. Of course, you know, it's really interesting. We're really not hearing very much at all after the fact about this whole thing. As far as I know, we still don't know, you know, what the other airline or what the other flight was that was involved in this, and the only thing that we have is the FAA and the NTSB are investigating. That's it. So hopefully we'll learn more about that. Okay, and then finally Larry says, that was my long-winded amateur analysis, which I guarantee is worth every penny that you paid for it, which of course is nothing. No, it was good analysis, Larry. Thank you. If you want to read Larry's analysis in full, in its entirety, head over to airlinepilotguy.com/, I guess this would be 118 that he put it on. Yeah, somewhere in there. Okay, and let's see. Yeah, that's it. So I'll move. Thanks, Low Time Larry, for your very entertaining comments. Okay, Ron says, great sight and love the podcasts. Thank you, Ron, and you can thank Arash up in Ontario, Quebec, Canada, for doing the website. And by the way, he's doing a lot of work behind the scenes to transition or transfer all of the files from the virtual shared hosting or whatever they call the type of hosting account that I have the site installed on at the moment. and he's moving it over to a dedicated virtual hosting kind of site. So it's gonna have better performance. So thank you, Arash, for all the work that you're doing with that and other things that we really can't talk about at this time. So we really do appreciate, all of you who listen to the show, who send me feedback, who contribute your hard-earned money, and send me, you're all great, fantastic. I really appreciate each and every one of you. Okay, a few questions for you. Have you flown into KBUF, Buffalo Niagara International Airport, I believe? And have you ever had to change planes after not finding the crash axe? Okay, I talked about, somebody had asked about the crash axe, on an earlier episode. And, I believe that I should have looked this up before I recorded this show, but I'm pretty sure that the crash axe is one of those things that you have to have. I'm not sure if I'd feel comfortable with getting on an airplane whose crash axe was missing. Where is it? Where'd it go? Did one of the ramp workers come up and take it? Or did a passenger somehow gain unauthorized access to the cockpit of the airplane and steal it? Catering? Who knows? Did somebody get on the airplane during boarding when the pilots weren't up in the cockpit and grabbed it and took it back in the back with them? I think that I would have serious problems with taking an airplane that had a crash axe missing from the cockpit. Have I ever had to cancel a flight because of it? No. And I don't know if there has been that situation in the past. Good question, though, Ron. And, of course, yes, I have flown into Buffalo many times over my more than 25 years flying at Acme Airlines. And, I love Buffalo. It's a great place. In the wintertime, it gets a little chilly, though. Okay, Michael from Tampa writes, "Hey, Captain Jeff, I've been watching your show for about a year now and have watched every episode. There's one question I never asked you. Do you use a flight simulator? Example, X-Plane 9 or Microsoft Flight Simulator X or 9? No, I don't. I personally use Microsoft Flight Sim 10, but I'm switching to X-Plane 10 in just a few weeks so I can use better software for my upcoming home cockpit. One last question, if you don't mind. What's your thoughts on virtual airlines? Thanks, Captain Jeff. Blue skies and tailwinds, Michael from Tampa Bay." I think virtual airlines are cool. A great way to learn about the airline business and work with dispatchers and other folks operating flights. Honestly, I don't know that much about it, but I'm amazed at all the infrastructure and all the attention to detail that happens in the flight simulator world, the PC simming world. Very, very impressed with it. But no, honestly, between flying these trips and doing this podcast, I really have little time for anything else. So thanks, Michael, as always. Let's see. Aditya Kurana. Aditya. Did I say that right? He says, "I'm a pilot from India. I've just started listening to your podcasts, and I'm really enjoying them and learning a lot through them. Keep up the good work. I have a question for you. There are different speed limitations for holding at different altitudes. For example, below flight level 140, 230 knots. Above flight level 140, 265 knots. And that's, by the way, the International Civil Aviation Organization rules, ICAO. What is the purpose of these different restrictions at different levels? Cheers. Thanks." Well, I'll have a link in the show notes to the excellent Wikipedia article about holding in aeronautics. It talks about holding pattern, standard entries, and timing, and all kinds of different interesting things, including speed restrictions. And basically, the reason why there are speed restrictions is that when you are doing a holding pattern that is not based on a distance or a certain set mileage, you have to adjust your holding pattern based on timing. And Your timing is based on the rolling out wings level on your inbound leg toward the holding fix. And then you adjust your outbound timing based on the winds and everything else to come up with the optimum timing. And so it's either going to be 1 minute inbound leg at the lower altitudes or 1.5 minutes at the higher altitudes. And the speed restriction is because the faster an airplane is flying, the greater the turn radius is. So if they're trying to keep these patterns within a certain amount of airspace, they restrict the speed so that they know that the airplane is going to stay within that, lateral confine. And so that's actually a very simple answer. The speed is because they don't want you to be making these huge turns. If you're flying at a much higher airspeed, they want to keep you in that, tight area. So again, you can learn all about holding patterns, holding pattern entry, maximum speeds, and holding fixes, and all kinds of interesting stuff by clicking on that link right there in the show notes about holding.
Say you should hear it. Oh, I'm happy to make time for your feelings.
And hello again. Now, if you happen to be watching the video, I don't know if you can tell a difference in the sound if you're just listening to the audio version, but I am in a different space entirely than I was when I answered the last question. And the last question was from Adit. Yeah, Corona, the question about holding. Well, after I answered his question, I looked at the clock and I thought, you know, need to take a break and need to eat. And so I went downstairs at the hotel restaurant and had a bite to eat for dinner. And then, of course, I started doing the calculations, figuring out, okay, when do I need to get up in the morning and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, as you suspect, I had to get a good night's sleep, so I started breaking down all the equipment, putting it all away, and getting packed up and ready for today's flying. And I got a pretty decent night's sleep. I am suffering a little bit still. I think my voice sounds a little bit better today than it did yesterday. My body's still trying to clear out all this gunk that it has in it. And I'm in Cleveland. See? I'm in Cleveland, Ohio, at the Radisson Hotel, very nearby the Cleveland Indians ballpark. They have a game tonight, although I don't think it's going to actually be played because I think it's like a 90% chance of rain here in Cleveland. Now, we made it from Dallas-Fort Worth to Atlanta with no weather issues at all, and then from Atlanta to here, just skirted around the eastern edge of a storm system, which is currently in southern Ohio. And so really no issues with that as well. A little bit of turbulence, but it wasn't that bad. And so here I am in Cleveland. Now, I mentioned earlier on this episode that I plan on meeting PJ Gustafson tonight, as well as Paul. Sorry, Paul, I don't recall your last name here. I'm going to try to pull that up while I continue talking to you who are listening to me on the show, and maybe others in case they happen to get a chance to come by downtown Cleveland. And we're going to enjoy some great local craft beer and some good food, and we're probably going to go over to the City Tap, which is right next door to the hotel. So, anyway, I'm trying to find. Well, it looks like he just goes by Paul. So, Paul and PJ and myself will be over at the City Tap next door to the Radisson Hotel here in Cleveland. So, Again, if you're listening to this right now and just learning about it right now, well, of course, it's too late. Oh, the other thing I wanted to say is I hope to, as long as I can get my iPad battery recharged quickly enough, take my iPad with me and then do a live meetup, virtual meetup, at the City Tap later today using my iPad and Ustream. And if you're interested in seeing what it looked like, it should still be there now by going to airlinepilotguy.com/live, and it should have recorded our little meetup. And that's my plan anyway. Of course, this is in the future as I speak right now, so who knows what will happen, you know, if there's going to be enough light or if I'm going to have enough power, etc. But I thought that at least this would be a way for so many of you who are not in the Cleveland area or who may not even be in the United States to kind of get a feel for what it might be like to go to an APG meetup. Yeah, it's just a bunch of guys and girls talking aviation and drinking beer and other beverages. Okay, so enough of that. Let's get back over here to the task at hand, which is answering your all-important questions. So let's start off this part of the episode with Ellis. He said, I would love a career in commercial aviation like you, but I guess it costs a lot of money to get the training, etc. As I am only 14, nearly 15, and I would love an aviation career, but my family isn't very rich, so I wouldn't have been able to go through a training scheme such as CTC Wings. So I joined the Royal Air Force Air Cadets Air Training Corps to help me get a career in the Royal Air Force and become a pilot in the Air Force. Because you had a career in the Air Force and you became a commercial pilot, I was wondering what extra training you had to complete in order to be qualified to fly commercially. It would be greatly appreciated if you could get back to me as soon as you can, giving me any information. Keep up the fantastic podcasts. And Ellis salutes me. Thank you, Ellis Martin. And I believe he's in the UK, obviously, because he joined the Royal Air Force cadets, air cadets. And I wrote back to Ellis, but I thought I'd share it with everybody listening to the show as well, that I think it's a grand idea to join the Air Force, Royal Air Force Air Cadet program, and hopefully get into the Royal Air Force. I think that the military training is top-notch, and that's the kind of training that I received myself. And your question was, what did I have to do to get trained, and what, you know, what things did I have to do so that I could fly civilian commercially? And basically, all I really had to do was take a little test, a written examination. I think it's called a civilian equivalency exam or something like that. And basically, it was just a couple-page test to test my general aviation knowledge. Excuse me. Oh, sorry about that. I still have some issues with the sinuses and stuff going on in my body. Is still trying to cough. Okay. I'll try to cut that out. So anyway, it was a very simple examination. And after you pass the examination, I think the pass rate, required pass rate, is like 70%. So it's not, you know, an extremely demanding test. You end up getting from the Federal Aviation Administration I got a commercial multi-engine limited to centerline thrust instrument rating. So what that meant was that because the airplane I was flying at the time when I took the test was the T-38, I think we did this at the end of our pilot training, so we really didn't even have our wings at this point, or maybe we just got our wings. I don't remember exactly what the chronology was on this, but anyway, because the airplane that we were flying at the time was the T-38, you know, twin-engine jet, multi-engine jet. The engines are like right next to each other, so they're aligned on the center line, as opposed to a multi-engine airplane like the C-141 or any of the airliners that have engines on the wings, where your thrust is not centerline thrust, but it's a non-centerline thrust. So, excuse me. Sorry for sniffing there. So that's what we had to do. So really hardly anything at all. And at the time that I interviewed with and was hired by Acme Airlines, the requirement for most of the major airlines was to have a commercial certificate. We didn't require, or it was not required to have an air airline transport pilot certificate to even get an interview. Now things have changed, of course. Now to get hired by any airline, you have to have the airline transport pilot certificate, the ATP certification. And so things are a little bit more strict now. So that's it, Ellis. So thanks for your question. And wish you luck in your career. Please keep us informed of your journey. Okay, this is from South Korea, Sangwoo Kang. He says, I hope you don't find my name hard to pronounce. Well, I don't think it is, but it's either Sangwoo Kang or Sangwoo Kang. He's from South Korea, who has been such a big fan of my podcast. He writes, just feeling compelled to tell you that your podcast has inspired and motivated me in so many ways ever since I decided to pursue my career in aviation. I started listening to your podcast to improve my English and familiarize myself with American accents, as I had been staying in Australia for about 5 years. Just got to tell you how much I love your charming American accent. Ha ha. Charming, huh? Okay. I'm just sending this message to let you know that there are a lot of people out there, not only in the United States, but from the opposite side of the world, that are inspired by you. Thank you so much for all the great work you've done. So he tells me to keep it up, and once again, he appreciates the dedication. Best regards from Sangwoo. And thank you, Sangwoo. You know, that reminds me, when I was in the military, in the Air Force, we had a crew rest. We didn't call it layovers back then. We called it crew rest. And we flew into the Royal Australian Air Force Base, and I can't think of the name of it right offhand, but it's just outside of the Sydney area. And we ended up, because they didn't have room for us on base, we ended up going downtown to one of the downtown hotels in Sydney. I think we were staying downtown. And a group of us was, you know, just walking around, taking in all the sights of Sydney. And we ended up befriending a group of Australian young people. Remember, you know, at this time I was probably 24, 25 years old, so I was a young Jeff. I wasn't even a Captain Jeff. I was a Lieutenant Jeff. And so we found this, likewise, about the same age group as our group. And I remember one of the girls who was talking, and she sounded normal to me. She was using a, quote, American accent. And I thought to myself, well, there's no such thing as an American accent. And we just thought her Australian accent was just, you know, delightful. And but they were laughing at her. You know, she was imitating our accent, and they just thought it was the funniest thing. And we kept looking at each other like, what? What is so funny? What is tickling these people so much? And she said, well, she sounds just like you. And I'm thinking, well, yeah, she does. What's wrong with that? So I'm glad that you like my charming American accent, Sangwoo, and thank you for listening, and I hope to continue to inspire people around the world, and good luck pursuing your career in aviation. Keep us up to date with that, if you don't mind. I am sorry, my nose keeps leaking, and I have to do something about that. All right. This is from Randall. This is a long one, so I better take a gulp of coffee here. Maybe I should play the Java jive again. Okay. Randall says, I'm a career U.S. Air Force pilot, 19 years, and have been watching and listening to your show since about episode 80. I've long known that I wanted to fly for the airlines after the military, so I've spent years learning about the airline pilot profession and consuming as much information about it as possible. Although I'm probably not the target audience for your show, I ran across your YouTube channel last year, found your show fun to listen to, and APG has been a constant companion to my workouts, runs, walks, etc. ever since. It has been both informative and entertaining. Well, thank you, Randall. I appreciate that. And, you know, as far as my target audience, I don't really know if I have a target audience. I just figure I'm the guy that has some experience flying in the airlines for a number of years. And if you don't have a next-door neighbor or a friend at church or whatever that is an airline pilot and you have all these questions about stuff, why shouldn't it be me? So that's why I started the show, so that I could answer all of your questions to the best of my ability. Okay, so in Airline Pilot Guy 117, a listener asked if the military had the same issues with automation use as the airlines seem to, so I thought I'd add my observations to the discussion. In my opinion, yes, at least in my sliver of experience in the U.S. Air Force, and probably in many of the same ways, and for many of the same reasons as in the Part 121 airline profession. I have a background flying fighters and instructing and trainers. It is absolutely not the norm to use automation in those communities, as most of the aircraft do not have systems resembling flight management systems and flight guidance systems. Some of them have rudimentary autopilot systems with simplistic functions like altitude hold, attitude hold, and the ability to follow pre-programmed inertial navigation system routes, and some don't have anything more fancy than a flight director. More importantly, since fighter and trainer aircraft are primarily designed to accomplish missions that require dynamic flight, it requires hand flying as the primary method of maneuvering the aircraft. Thus, pilots in these communities spend most of their time flying by hand, and these skills are well developed and frequently practiced. I'm sure you know that most fighter pilots would easily pride themselves on their ability to hand fly with precision. I know I do. And yeah, I would agree with you, Randall. And it actually extends more into not just the fighter community, but the training community that I was involved with, and even, I dare say, in the cargo transport category. I know that many of us took pride in our own skills and being able to fly the airplane with precision by hand, manually. Okay, back to Randall's feedback. Although I have no experience flying in the tanker, transport cargo, or other heavy communities, I've had the opportunity to fly with many U.S. Air Force pilots who do. I volunteered to fly a medium-sized corporate-type aircraft as a temporary duty in the USAF, and this aircraft had automation very typical to the airline world. In the process of flying this aircraft with many different pilots from many different U.S. Air Force aircraft, it was very interesting to see how different communities had different attitudes toward automation. We as pilots naturally tend to fall back on the habits we've learned over hundreds or thousands of flying hours, and when we were flying this airplane we were all new to, it was no different. In general, as would be expected, the pilots from the heavy backgrounds tended to prefer flying using the FMS or FGS, while the pilots from fighter and bomber backgrounds tended to prefer hand flying or using the flight guidance system. None of the methods was considered correct or incorrect, and the U.S. Air Force allowed pilots and crews to decide for themselves on any particular flight how they wished to accomplish it. Only rarely did I see pilots from any previous aircraft who I felt were overly reliant on automation or had some kind of subpar airmanship that seemed rooted in overuse of automation. I saw quite a lot of pilots from heavy backgrounds whose previous aircraft had policies or regulations that required them to use automation in the name of safety or efficiency, and those pilots tended to have less recency of experience hand flying. Those pilots thus were sometimes less precise, less smooth, and less accurate when they did have an opportunity to hand fly. Sometimes they were hesitant to click off the autopilot and tentative in their hand flying, but most of them predictably increased their proficiency with practice. Although some of them actively avoided opportunities to hand fly, most were happy to be in an aircraft that allowed them the freedom to do it. By the same token, on the opposite end of the spectrum, I also observed fighter and bomber community pilots who were very comfortable and skilled at hand flying. But when it was time to set up the GPS approach in the FMS on actual weather day, it was like dogs watching television. Many of these pilots were not used to flying with complex automation and could handle 99% of what was required to fly this aircraft by ignoring it and just old school hand flying. This situation, unfortunately, is just as much as a problem as over-reliance on automation. Aircraft are obviously designed with these systems for a reason, and the inability to proficiently use them, while probably not presenting an imminent danger to the operation of the aircraft, is just as much a deficiency in personal airmanship as the lack of ability to hand fly. Yeah, that's well said, Randall. As you've said several times while discussing automation on various APG episodes, as pilots, we need to keep all aspects of our skills sharp. And that means being just as proficient in using the automation as it does using the funny W-shaped thing that sits between our knees and the levers on the console to make the airplane do what we want it to do safely. I can't comment on if the U.S. Air Force heavy community is self-aware of over-reliance on automation use causing decreased proficiency in hand-flying skills, or if they have any kinds of programs in place to try and counter it. I have to think that there are a lot of very smart people flying airplanes in this service, and that they would, in fact, be aware of this and actively doing something about it. I wish I could say something intelligent regarding your observation that Acme pilots with a fighter background tend to be the ones who use automation the most. I don't really have any insight here, as I have precisely zero experience flying for a 121 airline. I will, however, say that my experience flying the corporate-type aircraft I described above was enlightening with respect to what aircraft automation can really do. Up to that point, in flying fighters and trainers, I'd never used an autopilot that could, for instance, fly an instrument approach hands-off or compute and perform a time or altitude ATC crossing restriction at a certain point. I have to admit, when I first started using it, I was completely enamored with it and with what it could do, and I tended to use it a lot, partly for the pure fascination of watching it in action, and partly because of how incredibly easy it made operating in the airspace system. I can easily see how pilots with thousands of hours of flying without such automation might get quickly and easily seduced into using it all the time. Thanks for listening to my feedback. Keep up the great work. It's a pleasure to listen to your show. And I hope to continue listening to it as I finish off my U.S. Air Force career and hopefully transition into a career at the airlines in the next year or so. Cheers, Randall. Well, Randall, man, I hope that I hope you interview with Acme Airlines, because we just based on your writing skills, sounds to me like you'd be a great addition to our fleet of pilots. Are pilots a fleet? No, our cadre of pilots, our group of pilots, whatever. Very well written. You have a great command of English and grammar, and I do appreciate that. And I really do appreciate your viewpoint, your perspective. And I guess I should say, you know, I know I did say that it seems like the people that come from military backgrounds that were in the fighter community tend to use it more than anybody else. Maybe that's a little bit biased. Maybe what I'm thinking is that I'm surprised that, or it would seem to me that the people that come from the fighter backgrounds would be the ones to, you know, want to use it the least amount, not the people that were doing it all the time in their previous, you know, flying career. But I can understand what your point regarding being enamored with what it can do and how easily it is to get seduced. And even, you know, I'm guilty of that. The autoflight systems do fly the airplanes very, very well. And in fact, it's always a challenge to me that when I'm hand flying, that I fly the airplane as smoothly or more smoothly than the autoflight system. And I can see how somebody who you know, kind of get seduced into using automation all the time would be reluctant to click off the thing and start practicing their hand flying skills because they may have become rusty over non-use. So again, I encourage all of you out there, if you feel like you're one of those that Randall is talking about that maybe have been seduced into using the automation all the time and are reluctant to click it off because maybe you feel like you might kind of embarrass yourself. Because, you know, we pilots are a prideful bunch. Most of us take quite a bit of pride in our skills, and we're always with somebody else. And so when we're turning off the autoflight system and we're hand flying the airplane, it's kind of, it's show off time, really. You know, we want to show the other person that we have the skills necessary to fly this airplane just as well as that darn autopilot does. Unfortunately, many of us don't want to take that on because, again, we may be embarrassed by the fact that our skills have eroded a bit. So anyway, very good points, Randall, and thank you for taking the time to respond to my question regarding, I wonder if these same issues with automation dependency are also out there in the military. So very good, very good. Okay, Frick says, I think on one of your episodes you talked about a British Airways pilot suing for poisonous gases that led to cancer. I just saw this today about a report in the Australian Transport Safety Board that they released, and I guess there was a... here, let me quickly look over here at my internet browser, and this is from, Reuters. The passengers and crew of Australian planes have been exposed to potentially toxic fumes on over 1,000 occasions, a report reveals. Former cabin crew are now taking legal action, alleging the exposure is linked to cancers and neurological disorders. And the article goes on to talk about the concern regarding this, although it also is balanced and says that there are some people here that say that there is no conclusive evidence yet to make the connection. So thank you, Frick, for sending that piece of feedback in. Sean in Sweden writes, greetings, Captain Jeff. I've been lucky enough to fly up front numerous times on the Mad Dog. Most of the folks I know learned to really like that airplane. Different rules here in Sweden and with Scandinavian Air Service. I think that's what the SAS stands for. If the captain knows you, then you can ride up front. Lucky me, except for the weird footrests for the jump seat. Price well worth it, though. Yeah, when you're sitting in the jump seat on the Mad Dog, you are almost straddling the center console. Not a lot of room up there as far as, from front to back, nose to tail kind of room. And so your legs basically are, the lower part of your legs are kind of between the seats, the pilot and co-pilot seats, and the center console. So we have these little things that fold up that you can kind of rest your feet on. Not quite stirrups, but something similar to that. And so that's what he's talking about. So Sean in Sweden goes on, I have also had the privilege of being an S4 rider on ACME. S4 is the buddy passes that many airlines use, and that's the priority level, which is not much priority when it comes to flying using a buddy pass. As I know other people in your line of work, been treated in a great way on all of my legs with ACME and appreciated. Blah, blah, blah. And that's what he says, not me. Sean says, blah, blah, blah. The reason I'm writing you is to provide you a tool that is excellent in convective forecasting. This tool is used by the SPC, the Storm Prediction Center, and basically the all-stars of weather forecasting in the United States, and gives you a 36-hour window and much more advanced than anything Weather Underground can do for you. I found it to be extremely accurate, not only with storm mode prediction, but also with the timing of convective initiation, cell strength, and location. The link is copied to this mail, and I recommend that you use the simulated composite radar reflectivity DBZ and echo tops. Being from Oklahoma originally, I have an appreciation for keeping an eye on the sky. And I guess that would be a smart thing to do if you grew up in Oklahoma, because they have a lot of tornadoes in Oklahoma. So, and he gives me the link. I'll have that link in the show notes, so make sure you look for that. And you're right, this is an excellent tool, Sean. I've been using it quite a bit since I found out about it through you. And you're right, it's a cool way of projecting what frontal systems are going to do and what storm cells are going to do and echo tops and how the storms build and dissipate, et cetera, over a 36-hour window. Of course, the farther you get away from the original projection, the more into voodoo territory you're getting, because, it's just the way, the nature of the beast. But I've been using it on this trip several times to kind of take a look at where I'm going to be flying and looking at the weather systems. And for instance, this one today that we flew to the east of, the system was kind of centered in southwestern Ohio. Basically, this forecasting tool nailed exactly where the position of the storm cells would be and the intensity and everything else. So, excellent, excellent tool for the weather geeks out there listening to the show. So, and you know what? I should say that more and more, the thing I like about Weather Underground is that I can go into the NEXRAD radar displays, and I have control over echo tops and other various aspects of looking at the individual NEXRAD radar sites. And that, to me, gives me more flexibility than the same kind of tools on other sites. But I do actually, now that I've thought about it a little bit more, I probably use the Aviation Digital Data Service, ADDS, aviation weather site by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. I think I got that right. NOAA, N-O-A-A. Their weather predicting tools, the U.S. government's weather site. I've been using the convective page quite a bit, and the extended convective forecast product, I think it's called the extended convective ECFP, I think is what they call it. And it gives you a graphical depiction of between 8-hour time periods. And the one I usually end up looking at is between 12 and 18 Z. Is that right? 12 and 18? Maybe that's only 6-hour increments. That makes more sense. I guess they break up the 24-hour periods into fourths. So the product I look at is the 12 to 18 Z forecast for convective potential. And that equates right now to 8 o'clock in the morning to 2 o'clock in the afternoon. As you know, that's usually the time frame where I'm flying most of the time. And I look at that and see where I could be experiencing some convective activity. And that is one of those things I check quite often. Of course, they have the convective forecast and other things within the convective page of the aviationweather.gov site. So I'll put some of those links in the show notes for you all to check it out. But thank you, Sean, for turning me on to the www.emc.ncep.noaa.gov/mmb/mpyle/spcprod/00. Did you get that? Of course you didn't. I just thought I'd have some fun with that. But anyway, just look for the link in the show notes. Okay, Matthias says, sorry if you've answered this question before, but unfortunately I can't always listen until the end of the show. Well, Matthias, that's a personal problem that you have. No, I'm just kidding. I know. These shows are sometimes extremely and excruciatingly long. And, of course, you can't always listen to everything. I listen to a lot of podcasts, but there are episodes that I listen to maybe a little bit of, and then I never get a chance to go back and listen to the whole thing. Or sometimes I skip, you know, one or two or more episodes just to kind of catch up with the latest. And I completely understand. So, it's either Matthias, and probably either of those pronunciations is acceptable. His question is, how are you and other pilots dealing with this annoying pressure in the ears while climbing and descending? Are you yawning every once in a while, or are you chewing gum? So most of the time, I think early on when I was flying unpressurized airplanes, I guess I was just kind of, you know, yawning, or actually just moving my jaw to kind of relieve that slight pressure that I had in my inner ear. Excuse me. And now I guess it just got to the point where I just don't think about it anymore. I think most of us who do this job for a living just automatically make whatever motion with our jaw is necessary to relieve pressure, and it's just become so commonplace that we don't even think about it. But there are times, like today, like my last flight, where, you know, you hear this congestion that I have right now, and honestly, you know, I'm really close to, you know, getting to the point where perhaps I should not be flying right now, because I do have some stuff going on with my sinuses and stuff. And the first and second day of the trip, I didn't have any problem. The first flight this morning between Dallas and Atlanta, I didn't have any problem at all with my ears. But this last flight between Atlanta and Cleveland, I did. And I'm not sure if it had something to do with the, it was the first officer's leg, and he was kind of doing more of those idle descents. And on the Mad Dog, when you do an idle descent, there's really not enough pneumatic or bleed air for the air conditioning packs to keep up with the pressurization. And so you end up kind of descending and climbing at a little bit higher rate than normal. And I don't know if that had something to do with it or just bad timing on my part, but I started having a little bit of trouble with my ears, and I had to do a Valsalva maneuver. And that is a maneuver where you actually close your nose. I'm putting my, as you can tell, I'm pinching my nose. And then you blow like you're blowing a balloon. And that pressure kind of forces your eardrum or your inner ear or your eustachian tube, or I don't know. I'm not a doctor. Dr. Steph, help me. It forces the inner ear to open and equalize the pressure. And so I had to do the Valsalva maneuver a couple times on descent today into Cleveland. And so I'm hoping that my sinus system will be a little bit more dried out before I fly tomorrow. I have three legs tomorrow. And, you know, I don't enjoy having to deal with that nuisance, as you put it very well, Matthias. So, yeah, I guess occasionally I see guys chewing gum. Maybe they're doing it because of that process where they, you know, but I really do think that most of us who have been flying for years and years and years just kind of automatically just make that motion with their jaw, the same kind of motion that you would make if you were yawning, to kind of stretch the membranes or whatever you're doing to equalize the pressure. And if you are experiencing, you have some congestion, as I do right now, and if there's any way that you can postpone flying, I would recommend that you do, because you're going to be much more sensitive to the changes in pressure than you would be if everything is running normally in your head. And of course, things aren't ever running normally in this head. Okay, so Matthias says, by the way, if you ever come to Munich again, just let me know so we can have a beer or two. As far as I know, you can start under every wind condition, and you don't need to fly via Frankfurt to the United States. And even a third runway is planned, so your future trips to Germany will be less stressful. Thank you, Matthias. And I love Germany, especially Bavaria, Munich is a great city, and I will definitely give you a call. Of course, he didn't give me his number, but I'll send you an email if I'm ever in Munich again, and we'll enjoy some good... Does Germany make beer? Okay. And that was being facetious or sarcastic or ironic or whatever it was. It was kind of being fun. John writes, just a quick note of thanks for your one... Oh, let's see. In episode 118, you spoke about FedEx Flight 705. I wanted to pass along a YouTube link to the Discovery Channel Mayday episode concerning this flight. The link is, and he gives me the link. Don't worry, I'm not going to read out the link again. I found this episode extremely interesting, and the heroism of the flight crew cannot be described in words. Perhaps you've already watched this, but I thought I'd send it along the same. Yeah, I did see it. It's been a while, so maybe I'll go back and look at it again, John. He says, on a different note, my votes are as follows. Longer APG episodes, check. APG or Acme Airlines coffee mugs, check. Thanks again, Captain Jeff, and God bless, John. Well, thank you, John, for your votes. I'll take that all into consideration. And, yeah, you know, when I have a little extra time, which I don't seem to have a lot of lately, I intend to bake up some mugs, coffee mugs, with the APG logo or the Acme Airlines logo or both, whatever. So I'll let everybody know when that happens. Okay, Alan writes, let's see, he's from Derbyshire. I would look at it as an Anglican, Derbyshire, but I know that's not the way you pronounce that in the UK. So I'm going to say Derbyshire and hope that that's right in the United Kingdom. I first came into contact with you when you appeared on the Airplane Geeks some time ago and have been hooked ever since. I personally love the podcast and like the fact that it's quite long. It helps my long drives with my job go much quicker. So Alan votes for... the same way as John, apparently. I have a few questions about the interior maintenance on the MD series, which you fly at Acme. I am an engineer in the railway, and trains have a similar lifespan to planes, and we typically refresh units around the 10 to 12-year mark with a full refit at 20 years of age. Typically, the life expectancy of trains is about 35 years, but usually they can be made to go quite a bit longer if looked after. How often do the interiors of airliners like the Mad Dog get refreshed to bring the fabrics, lockers, and seat panels up to date? One step on from refreshing, do older planes like the MD series ever have a full refit where they would, for example, be taken out of service and the total interior ripped out to renew the seats, carpets, etc.? I imagine there must be something in place to work on the underfloor systems periodically, so... it would seem like an opportune time to align the activities to save on maintenance costs. Also, I imagine that there could be opportunities for weight saving if seats were being renewed, as I would have to assume that newer seats would probably be able to be both lighter and stronger due to the advances in material and design technology over the years. Or is this simply too costly and they just renew the parts that break and replace the fabrics, foams, etc. when required? Now, I know the airlines care what the customers think of the interiors, so I imagine they keep them up to date for the most part. But does this mantra extend to the cockpit? When they refresh the interiors, do they also refurbish the cockpit at the same time? I realize pilot seats, like train driver seats, are very expensive, and I would imagine that they treat its components on condition and renew the parts as they become worn. But would there come a point where they would just clean out the cockpit, throw the seats, or have them overhauled, refurbish all the panels, and update the instruments? The last part leads me nicely into the glass cockpit upgrade to the MD series at Acme. When is this planned to happen, and have you had a chance to see or train on the new systems? Finally, you, some time ago, said that you were... due to get tablet upgrades to allow you to ditch your charts at Acme. did this happen? How are you getting on with them? And has it been the revolution you've hoped for? Can you now get away with a much lighter luggage complement as a result? You mentioned that Acme wasn't getting iPads, but another brand of tablet. What do they like to use, and can use them for personal ventures like browsing the net, downloading apps? Excuse me. Man, my body is just having a fit over here. Hang on. Let me do some more coughing. Okay. Can we use them for personal things like browsing the net, downloading apps, checking your company email, etc.? Or are they locked down to company-controlled apps that only show you what you need to replace to the charts? Sorry for all the questions. It takes me ages to pluck up the courage to write. So all my questions come out in one big lump. Blue skies, tailwinds at altitude, etc., etc. Best wishes and kind regards, Alan. Well, thanks, Alan. A lot of good questions. Airlines do quite often refresh the interiors of airplanes. And, number one, because they get worn. Number two, it gives you the impression that when you're in an airplane that has that kind of, new car smell, that the airplane is new as well. Now, we all know that if you're flying on a Mad Dog on Acme Airlines, that these were delivered in the very late 80s and most of the 90s through the mid to late 90s. And so these are not brand new airplanes, but, for a typical passenger getting on these jets, when they come in and see these nice new interiors, they think, this is a new airplane. I feel safe. So that's part of it, I'm sure. The latest cabin refresh at Acme on the jet that I fly is very nice. In fact, I flew one today that had the new mod on it, and all the seats are actually fitted or covered with leather. These are not the same original seats that were on the airplane to begin with, as far as I know. So I suspect that you're right, Alan, that the seats not only being more comfortable, they probably weigh less, which, lends to lightening up the entire empty weight of the airplane. I'm assuming that this is reflected in the data that's used to do all the load planning and everything else. And the overhead bins have been enlarged because we've seen a shift in the way people carry luggage. And I know that that's in great part to a lot of the big airlines charging extra fees for checking their luggage. And so more and more people are bringing their luggage on board the airplane with them. So that's necessitated the refurbishment and increased size of the lockers, as you say, or the overhead bins. And lighting has improved. The more modern cabin interiors now use LED lighting, which not only gives it a newer, more bright look inside the cabin, it also is a safety thing. I think the LED lighting is a little bit safer, and it also doesn't put out as much heat as the incandescent lighting that it replaces. Now, I know a lot of the lighting was also fluorescent, but again, I think that an LED lighting system is a little bit more safer because the fluorescent units used ballasts that is part of the apparatus of lighting a fluorescent bulb. You have to have a ballast that provides the energy to ignite the fluorescent gases, and sometimes these ballasts can go bad and even catch on fire. So the cabin refreshing is good in many ways. So it's good for the passengers as far as feeling like we're in a new airplane, smelling like we're in a new airplane, more comfortable seats, etc. Now, as far as how often this occurs, I would just have to guess every probably 3 to 5 years, but I'm not sure what the actual replacement or refurbishing cycle is. Now, the airplanes themselves, mechanically, the things that you can't see inside the cabin, they are scrutinized quite well and quite often at various cycles. I think there are certain pressurization cycles they keep track of, and they also have certain time frames that they have to look at as well for inspections of the airframe and possible reconditioning of parts and replacement of parts and that kind of thing. Now, as far as your question about does this cabin refurbishment apply to the cockpit? And sadly, no. If you've ever been privileged enough to ride in a corporate jet, you'll notice that or look at Flying Magazine or one of the many excellent magazines out there that show you the interiors of these really nice corporate jets. You'll look and see, wow, everything looks all nice and shiny and clean. And the cockpit doesn't look worn at all. But that was one of those things that really took me aback when I first started flying in the airlines. You look at the cockpit and you think, wow, this kind of looks like the interior of a bus. And because, you know what, it doesn't really matter what the cockpit looks like for the passenger, right? They're concerned about the cabin and their surroundings, not what our cockpit looks like. So the cockpits in modern jetliners, unless you happen to see one or get to fly in one that is a new airplane, which I have not been able to do yet, sadly. Maybe one of these days I'll get to be in a cockpit, flying an airplane with a cockpit or an airplane that's new. It still has that new airplane smell, but so far I have not. So the airplanes that I tend to fly are ones that have been around for quite some time, are well worn and airworthy. Their airworthiness has been proved over time, and we have, you know, like little covers and fascia or whatever you call it that are supposed to be covering up like the various parts of the interior around the windows and everything else that are kind of hanging down, and you can see the insulation stuff behind it, and it kind of looks like something you don't want to touch. And it can look pretty worn and ragged. If I think about it, I will take a picture of the control yoke and maybe some of the other, maybe the throttle knobs on the airplane, and maybe I'll make that the cover of this episode, and you can see how well worn these airplanes are, and you can see where the paint has been rubbed off, and the metal is smooth over years and years of pilots' hands touching the control yoke, etc. So yeah, no, the cockpit refurbishment does not occur that often. And your question regarding the Mad Dogs at Acme, and we were supposed to be getting this new cockpit upgrade, instrumentation upgrade, you know, with the flat panel displays and all that kind of stuff. Well, that was put on hold because apparently the company that we contracted with led us to believe that it would be just an easy process of pulling out all the old instruments and putting in the new and using the same wiring harnesses and cannon plugs and all that kind of stuff. And apparently that didn't really work out as well as they thought. And so they basically told our company that it was going to take much, much longer than they had anticipated to make this transition, and going to be a lot more expensive as well. Now, couple this with the fact that these airplanes that we're using, you know, the Mad Dogs at Acme are basically the workhorse of the fleet. We carry more passengers more often than any other airplane in the fleet, and we really can't spare taking one or two or more of these airplanes out of service to have this retrofit performed and until they can get it down to a very short time frame. So that whole thing, I think, again, this is all rumor, but by now, we were supposed to have had a couple of these airplanes, prototypes, flying around the system, and as far as I know, there are none. So who knows exactly what's going on with that retrofit. Maybe the decision has already been made to not do it after all and just wait for new airplanes to replace these airplanes that we're flying right now. So we'll have to wait and see. Now, regarding the the tablet devices replace, you know, the Jeppesen, what do we call that? Electronic flight bags. That process has also been delayed. You are correct that we did not go with the Apple iPad product. Our company went with Microsoft's Surface, and that's kind of in limbo as well. Apparently, there are still some things being ironed out, and that has been delayed at least 2 months. So I think the latest correspondence we received regarding that says that the earliest that we'll see some of these things starting to hit the line will be mid to late summer. And I would suspect that it's probably going to even extend beyond that. So, but I'll certainly let you know when I have my hands on one of these new electronic flight bag, these EFB devices, and what I think about them. Now, I am part of a program using my own personal device. I have an iPad, fourth generation, that I have installed the Jeppesen FD Pro, I think they call it, Flight Deck Pro software, which basically has all the approach plates and arrivals and departures and taxi airport diagrams and special pages and all the stuff that we carry in our flight kits, which we actually don't carry anymore. We switched over to into the airplanes as opposed to each pilot being issued a set of manuals that we carry around everywhere with us. So we've been doing that now for a few years, and we are now used to it, and we're very, very pleased with, at least most of us, as far as I know, with the fact that we don't have to worry about doing all when we get the new pack of changes, what do they call that? Darn it. Oh, well, I'll think of it as soon as I finish recording. Every 2 weeks, Jeppesen put out these packets that we had to go in and, you know, pull this one out and put this one in. And now we don't have to do that anymore because the ship sets, full manuals, Jeppesen manuals, are being maintained by a separate department, and we don't have to worry about it. And we don't have to lug around these big flight kits anymore. So we still have to carry around, you know, our headsets if we use our personal headset, and other items that we may use during a flight. And that's why I've been using my Brightline bag, my flight gear bag, which I love. And unfortunately, I guess we're not getting that that 10% discount anymore. So I apologize to those of you who have gone back to earlier episodes of Airline Pilot Guy and thought they could order a Brightline flight gear bag and get that 10% discount. Apparently that's no longer working. But anyway, I like my flight gear bag. Still use it every trip. Where was I? I was getting off track here. So so I've been using my personal iPad, which is being used right now to do the video recording of the show. And I can go in there, and the problem with it right now is that we have not received FAA approval to use the tablet device below 10,000 feet. So I can only refer to it above 10,000 feet. But I use it to do my briefings and look at the arrival procedures and the altitude and speed restrictions and look at the approach plates, et cetera. And I really love it, and I can't wait till we have replaced all the paper with electronic devices. I think it's the future, and for a lot of airlines, it's the future is already here. So hopefully soon, and I'll let you know, Alan. And let me make sure I've answered all of your questions. I think so. Yeah. So thanks again for listening, Alan, and sending in your feedback. And again, I hope I answered all those. And if not, please write me again. All right. Well, it's time to take a little break so I can blow my nose. So I'll be right back. I guess I really didn't have to tell you what I was doing, did I? Sorry. Okay, Kevin writes, this will introduce a whole new dimension to the side stick versus control yoke debate in the area of feedback. As always, best wishes and appropriate winds for your flight phases. Respectfully, Kevin St. John. And he sends me a link to Science Daily, sciencedaily.com, in this particular article, Using Thoughts to Control Airplanes. And they have a picture here of a pilot in a simulator wearing a, basically looks like a skull cap with all these electrodes and wires sticking out of it. Does not look like it's a very attractive thing. But this pilot is wearing a white cap with a myriad of attached cables. His gaze is concentrated on the runway ahead of him. All of a sudden, the control stick starts to move, as if by magic. The airplane banks and then approaches straight on towards the runway. The position of the plane is corrected time and time again until the landing gear gently touches down. During the entire maneuver, the pilot touches neither pedals nor controls. This is not a scene from a science fiction movie, but rather the rendition of a test at the Institute for Flight System Dynamics of the Technische Universität München. Again, I probably butchered that. TUM in Munich. Scientists working for Professor Florian Holzapfel are researching ways in which brain-controlled flight might work in the EU-funded project Brain Flight. According to aerospace engineer Tim Frick, a long-term vision of the project is to make flying accessible to more people. With brain control, flying in itself could become easier. This would reduce the workload of pilots and thereby increase safety. In addition, pilots would have more freedom of movement to manage other manual tasks in the cockpit. And so basically what's happening here is that it continues, in order for humans and machines to communicate, brain waves of the pilots are measured using electroencephalography, EEG, electrodes connected to a cap. An algorithm developed by scientists from the Department of Biological Psychology and Neuroergonomics at the Berlin Institute of Technology allows the program to decipher electrical potentials and convert them into useful control commands. Only the very clearly defined electrical brain impulses required for control are recognized by the brain-computer interface. This is pure signal processing. Mind reading is not possible. So if you want to read more about this, I'll have a link in the show notes. And by the way, I saw many other articles in Science Daily that looked really interesting, and I hope to get a chance to read them when I get the time. So thank you, Kevin, for your input regarding feedback. And that's one of the things I think they're grasping with this brain flight technology, is the fact that what is the feedback? Side stick controllers, we talked about that, where you put in an input, but there's really no feedback that you're getting. Now, if you fly an airplane that has conventional controls, even those airplanes that have fly-by-wire systems like the Boeing 787, the Boeing 777, the system is designed to give feedback. So when you're actuating the control yoke or turning it to the right, it's not like you're just, actuating a toy and it's just moving without any kind of resistance. It actually has computers and servos and devices on there to make you feel like this is what it would feel like if you were actually actuating those controls. Now, the airplane that I fly doesn't have to do simulated feedback because I actually get the actual feedback from the control surfaces because everything is manual and connected with cables, which is one of the cool aspects of the airplane that I fly, I think. Okay, moving on. Tim writes, in your last podcast, or one of my previous podcasts, you had a link on your site for an Iran Fokker F-100. Fokker, let me pronounce it that way. So there's no indecision or misunderstanding what I've just said. An Iran Fokker F-100 that landed with its left main landing gear that had been failed. But I was thinking, wouldn't it be safer to have landed the aircraft completely on his belly than landing the way it did? If you were the captain of that aircraft, would you have done it this way or put it down on its belly? I thought you could have more control on your belly than two-thirds of your landing gear, as once the speed decreased enough, the wing could drop and dig into the runway and spin or flip the aircraft. If you landed on your belly, could you control your aircraft with the rudder? I look forward to your opinion. As always, take care. Best wishes. Safe flying. As always, cheers. Tim. Well, Tim, good question. And I'm sure that the pilots of the Iranian jet, the Fokker F-100 that landed with its left main landing gear up, consulted their abnormal or their emergency checklists, their QRHs, and to see what was recommended for this particular problem. And I'm guessing and assuming that it says the same thing as mine. Our quick reference handbook for the Mad Dog at Acme, which is basically the Boeing quick reference handbook for the airplane, says that landing with whatever you have is better than landing without any gear at all. So in this situation, if I were flying the airplane tomorrow and had a left main gear, I hope this doesn't happen that I'm talking about it now, the left main gear does not extend, they tell us that we are to land with the right main landing gear extended and the nose wheel extended as well. And said that the main landing gear is designed to shear when appropriate or if necessary to protect the aircraft and the fuselage. And it advises us to land on the side that you have the good main landing gear. So in this case, if the left main was up, we would try to land as close as we could to the right side of the runway, because we know that as the speed starts bleeding off and we can no longer hold up the left wing, that it's going to drop, and that's when we're going to, you know, have a tendency to have more drag, obviously, on that side of the airplane, and it's going to tend to want to turn the airplane to the left, which is, I believe, what happened with this this episode in Iran. And it says to use the brakes as necessary to get the airplane stopped, and tells us to hold off that left wing as, or whatever wing on the side of the airplane that doesn't have the landing gear extended, for as long as possible and until the controls no longer have any authority. And what else does it say? To try to find a runway that is as long as possible and as wide as possible. So this might be one of those cases where you look on your airport diagram and try to find out if this airport has a 200-foot wide runway as opposed to the more standard 150-foot wide runway. And that, of course, is to give you more margin to control the airplane as it decelerates to a stop. So, yeah, that's what my manual says to do, just the way they did it. As far as your question about, you know, landing with, let's say, both main landing gear or none of the landing gear extends, do you have any control over the airplane without any gear at all? And yes, you have control as long as the rudder has authority, but below a certain speed, the airflow moving over the rudder surface will be insufficient to provide any directional control. And from that point on, you're basically in a sled with no control of where the airplane's going. So hopefully you have a nice velocity vector and it's pointed straight down the runway. For instance, the 767, the Polish airline 767 that landed gear up, belly up, last year or the year before, it pretty much slid straight down the runway. So I guess they were able to control at least some of the direction on the early phase of the landing. And then again, at the latter phase, you know, the rudder is not effective and they're just along for the ride. Thanks for your question, Tim. And let's move on with Arun. A-R-U-N. Arun? Arun? I love the details you shared about TCAS response. Just wondering, does the Traffic Collision Avoidance System, TCAS, take into account when the aircraft is operating at the edges of the flight operating envelope? No, it doesn't. One thing I learned from Air France 447 is that the main reason for the crash is a high-altitude stall. Now, suppose the paths of two aircrafts coincide at 38,000 feet. Will TCAS of one airplane respond with a descend advisory and not suggest any correction for the other airplane? I'm not sure I know the answer to that question. Maybe some of these resources for TCAS would, but I have a feeling, based on my rudimentary understanding of the TCAS system, that in the case that you have presented, one airplane would be given a descend advisory, the other would be given a climb advisory. And so going on with Arun's feedback, if it doesn't, is the aircraft with a climb advisory at risk? From what I understand from the Air France 447, a 2-degree climb could result in a stall if kept at that altitude for extended periods of time as the engine runs out of power. Thinking of it logically, it feels like the range of both TA and RA should be extended dynamically as altitudes increase, as the responsiveness of the aircraft will be reduced. I'm sure someone has thought of this scenario, and pilots probably do operate with safe margins of error. Just wondering if there were any regulations or specifications covering it. Well, from what I could determine, Arun, aircraft performance in general and current performance capabilities in particular, like due to aircraft active aircraft configurations, are not taken into account in the current version of TCAS that we're using, which is TCAS 2, version 7, I think. So they're, the performance capabilities are not taken into account, so that it is theoretically possible that resolution advisories are issued that demand climb or sink rates outside the normal safe flight envelope of an aircraft during certain phases of flight. Furthermore, as well as all traffic is being dealt with equally, there's no distinction taking place between different types of aircraft, neglecting the option of exploiting aircraft-specific performance information to issue customized and optimized instructions for any given traffic conflict. For instance, by issuing climb instructions to those aircraft that can provide the best climb rates, while issuing descend instructions to aircraft providing comparatively better sink rates, thereby hopefully maximizing altitude change per time unit, or that is separation. Let's see. To overcome some of these limitations, the FAA is developing a new collision avoidance logic based on dynamic programming. And they're also doing some research into a new type of airborne collision avoidance system that they're calling ACAS, using this new logic. ACAS, A-C-A-S-X-A, will be a direct replacement for TCAS-2 using active surveillance. ACAS-XO will be collision avoidance tuned to work in some currently difficult operational situations, notably closer spaced parallel approaches. ACAS-XU will allow multiple sensor inputs and be optimized for unmanned airborne systems. That's interesting. I guess when they were developing TCAS, they never even thought about UAVs. And ACAS-XP will be designed for aircraft with only passive surveillance, in other words, ADS-B. The first FAA-scheduled industry was held in October 2011 in Washington to brief avionics manufacturers on the development plans for ACAS-X, including flight demonstrations scheduled for fiscal 2013. I'm not sure if those actually happened. Basically, the article I was reading said it is estimated if ACAS-X will be further developed and certified, ACAS-X will not be commercially available before the mid-2020s. So, and it also at this point, they're not sure if this is going to also provide horizontal resolutions as well as vertical. Right now, it's just vertical. No horizontal directions, any turn guidance is given for avoiding conflicts. So now, Jeff speaking, I was reading that from a couple different resources. I think that you made the point that, for instance, Air France 447, a 2-degree climb could result in a stall if kept at an attitude for extended periods of time. Well, that's the whole point of TCAS. TCAS is designed to provide a somewhat gentle climb or descent initially after a certain reaction time, and to provide basically minimum spacing or separation. And it's not supposed to last for an extended period of time. So even if you were flying an airplane at its operational ceiling, if you were given a climb resolution, the airplane has sufficient safety margin and energy margin to at least briefly climb or descend, as long as you're doing it the way that TCAS envisions that you're going to react as a pilot, to keep within safe parameters. I think most airplanes have those kind of safety margins built in. But of course, if you're going to hold your do a 2-degree climb for an extended period of time, then I think, you know, you're in a different situation. You're not in a traffic collision resolution advisory anymore. I don't know what you're doing. But again, for these things should be brief periods of time to resolve the separation, not extended. So I don't think that it's been a major issue. Could be wrong, but the future looks like we're going to see something, though, that will take into account performance capabilities of airplanes. Okay. Thank you, Arun, for your question about TCAS. Now, let's let somebody else talk for a while. How about Sport Pilot Dave? He wants to talk again about the effort to give... well, you know what? I'm just going to let him talk. He'll explain it. So take it away, Sport Pilot Dave.
Hi, Skipper. As is my bent, I'm continuing to ask your listeners to support the expansion of the use of a driver's license medical qualification conjoined with a pilot's duty to self-assess her own condition before climbing into the cockpit in lieu of the third-class medical now required by the FAA for recreational, that is, non-commercial pilots. The evidence is clear that the third-class medical is effective only in increasing the cost burden on general aviation without any benefit to the public. Expanding the driver's license medical will give GA a much-needed shot in the arm and open up the world of aviation to a broad cross-section of people who want to fly or to continue to fly. I'm looking at airplanes to buy, but under the existing rules, I can't look at Cessna 172s or 182s or Pipers or any of the thousands of older but still airworthy airplanes out there for sale. So instead of getting a safe but older airplane for, say, $25,000 or $30,000, I'm looking at an entry point of $70,000 and up. Please, aviators and aviation enthusiasts, pick up a phone or a keyboard and contact your elected representatives and ask or demand that they support the General Aviation Pilots Protection Act of 2014, referred to as GAPA. Doing so might also help move the FAA along on its already underway rulemaking process to eliminate the third-class medical for recreational pilots. Thanks for your support of GA, Skipper. Sport Pilot David.
You're welcome, Sport.
And I've copied the link to an op-ed piece by Representative Todd Rokita. I've copied the link below in the text portion of this email. Thanks again.
You're welcome. Sorry, I talked over you there. So that link will be in the show notes, and I'm more than happy to try to help out with passing this driver's license medical qualification and self-assessing of his or her own condition before climbing into the cockpit for sport pilots. So Again, if you're interested in helping out with that, the link to the op-ed piece by Representative Todd Rokita is linked in the show notes. So good luck with that, Sport Pilot Dave. I'm sure you'll keep us apprised as to its progress through Congress, or lack thereof. Okay, and more audio feedback, this time from Christopher.
Hello, Captain Jeff. This is Christopher from Hanover, Germany. This is my first feedback, and I have a question regarding takeoffs and landings. I work here as a guitar teacher, and 2 years ago, I had a student who flew, but I think he still flies, for a major European airline on the 747. And just before we met, he had transitioned from the A320 family to the 747. And I remember that he said that he made very few landings on the 747 compared to the A320 family. And that leads me to the question, is there a minimum number of landings or takeoffs a commercial pilot has to perform, let's say, every year or so? Or is there no regulation? Yeah, that's my question, and I wish you always clear skies, tailwind, and keep up the great work. Bye.
Thank you, Christopher, for your first voice feedback. It was fantastic. I do appreciate your effort in doing that. And if you, listener, want to do it yourself, most of these smartphones that we all carry around have recording apps, like a voice memo app or whatever. And just use that to record your feedback, like you're talking to somebody on the phone, and attach it to an email or send it directly to feedback@airlinepilotguy.com. And I found that the voice feedback that I get from people using these voice recording apps on their smartphones are the highest quality. SpeakPipe is also very high quality as well, which uses the built-in microphone of your device, whether it be a laptop or a desktop computer or a tablet device or a smartphone, whatever. That's also a great way to leave voice feedback. And of course, if you don't have access to any of those other things, you can always call the voice feedback line, which is area code 99 pilot. Again, area code 304-997-4568. And that's my Google Voice feedback line. Okay, so your question regarding currency. When you fly an airplane as the one, as I do, the Mad Dog that flies very short to medium range kind of flight stages, and you go on a trip, like this typical four-day trip that I'm flying here, three legs the first day, two legs the second, two legs the third, three legs the fourth, so that's six, seven, eight, nine, ten legs. And a lot of four-day trips are actually more like 12 to 15 flight segments. But you can see that by flying a narrow-body airplane that makes a lot of these short to medium-range flights, you get a lot of takeoffs and landings. And also, another point to take into consideration is that most of the time, it's just two of us, a pilot and a co-pilot, or a captain and a first officer. And we trade off back and forth, back and forth. There is a requirement, at least in the FARs, the Federal Aviation Regulations, that require us to maintain our landing, takeoff and landing currency. We must have three takeoffs and landings every 90 days. So basically every 3 months, we must have at least three landing episodes. I'm not sure if it's, well, I think it assumes takeoffs and landings. I think those are usually paired together. So for me, I will end up getting five flight segments, five takeoffs and five landings on the trip that I'm on right now, and that's just this four-day trip. So obviously I'm exceeding the requirement for every 90 days by just flying this one trip. Now, you transition to an airplane that is a long-range airplane. So a typical, let's say, three-day trip, the international flights that we have operating out of Atlanta, for instance, that go to somewhere in Europe, A three-day trip would consist of one flight from Atlanta to, let's say, Frankfurt, Germany, and then they have a 24-hour layover, and they have one flight back to Atlanta, one takeoff and one landing. Okay, so you're thinking to yourself, well, that shouldn't be a problem because you only have one pilot, or two pilots on the airplane. So you split those, so each of you get a takeoff and a landing, and you do one or two of those a month, and you should be able to keep your currency without a problem. Well, the problem is that these longer flights require either an augmented crew member position, so you have really three pilots on board that have to kind of decide who gets the takeoff and landing so that they can update or keep their currency. And then some flight segments or stage lengths actually require two full crews. So you have two captains and two first officers, so you have four pilots on board the airplane. And so you can see it gets more and more complicated to try to maintain your landing currency on these long-range categories. And I was talking to a guy on a flight back from Los Angeles that is a co-pilot on the 777 at ACME. And he said because he lives in Atlanta, he usually defers to any of the other pilots that may be commuters to go ahead and get their landings and takeoffs, because he knows that all he needs to do is once every 3 months go and visit the simulator complex in Atlanta at ACME headquarters and go into one of the simulators and knock out three takeoffs and landings in the simulator. And that takes all of, I think, 45 minutes. He said, you know, he's on a first-name basis with everybody there, and they know exactly what he needs to do to go into the simulator and get the landing currency. So, yes, you can actually, the simulators are so good now that you can actually regain or maintain your landing currency on the jet that you're flying by just, you know, doing a quick simulator period. So that's definitely something that I don't have to worry about, but I would have to worry about if I were flying an international category. So there you have it. And thanks again, Christopher, for your great audio feedback. Jack writes, I'm 13. I'm a 13-year-old aviation enthusiast from the Atlanta area. I think it's so cool that you fly the classic Mad Dogs or MD-88s for a living. I enjoy going to the Atlanta airport and watching them take off. One thing has me puzzled about them. Why are their takeoffs so steep? Having flown them many times, I felt these incredibly steep takeoffs. Also, the other day, I was at the airport watching a KLM 777 landing. As he exited the runway, his flaps were still down, and they stayed down as he began taxiing to the gate. Do you have any idea as to why he kept his flaps down? It would be awesome if you included this in the show. Thanks for reading. Sincerely, Jack. Well, great, Jack. Thanks for sending in your feedback, and thanks for listening to the show. So, first part of your question regarded the steep climb out. And yes, this airplane has a much steeper climb out than any of the airplanes I've ever flown, and it's only the initial climb. And that's because there are certain speeds that we're looking for, and the speed that we're looking for is our V2 plus 10 speed minimum, and it can go a little bit faster than that. But you're basically looking to get the deck angle up around 18, 19, and sometimes 20. 20 degrees is our limit. So if we go a little bit above 20 degrees nose high, we're supposed to correct back down and accept any faster speed that may accrue with that lower deck angle. But the reasoning is the engineers have determined that that's the safest way to get the airplane into flight above the ground and maintain all the safe parameters of flying. And so that initial 1,000 feet, we go right, we do our rotation, and we go all the way up to about 20 degrees nose high, and then make adjustments accordingly to maintain our airspeed at that minimum of V2 plus 10. And then at 1,000 feet, we start bringing the nose down, we start accelerating, and that's when we start cleaning up the flaps and the slats and all that. So, and I guess it's just the way the airplane was designed. The McDonnell Douglas engineers just made the airplane that way, I guess. I don't know. But you're right, it does seem to be a little bit steeper than a typical airliner trajectory, as far as the deck angle, at least, is concerned. The 777, the KLM 777 that you watched, keeping their flaps out, I suspect that they've just done this ocean crossing. They are quite fatigued and weary after having flown across the pond. And flying into the world's busiest airport, things can get really, really, really busy very quickly. And you're given a lot of instructions after clearing the runway. And it's possible, you also have the language thing, you know, English is not, I'm sure, the Dutch pilot's normal or native language. So you have that little extra thing thrown in there because you're listening to instructions in English, which is not your native language. And so you're concentrating on getting the airplane on the right taxiways and headed toward the correct ramp and the gate and all that kind of stuff. So I have a feeling that in the case that you witnessed, that the co-pilot who was responsible for cleaning up the flaps and bringing them up and doing all that, all the cleanup items, what we call our after landing checklist, probably got a little distracted and forgot that he had not or she had not raised the flaps. That's my guess. Other reasons for leaving the flaps out. When we're flying in the time of year where you could be picking up icing on your approach and landing, we are advised to leave our flaps in the landing configuration so that an inspection can be made before retracting them, because they can break things if you have ice formed on the flaps and other control surfaces. But in this case, I'm assuming that you saw this quite recently, and if you've been to Atlanta in the last few months, you know that there probably wasn't any ice on approach and final and landing. So I'm guessing it was just the co-pilot was distracted and eventually realized, oh, the flaps are still out. Let me retract the flaps. Now, some airlines actually have a procedure to leave the flaps extended until they arrive at the gate, and then I think they retract them. I think AirTran is one that does that, and perhaps, I'm not sure I understand why, but I suspect that it has something to do with the fact that their company, their management, their training people want pilots to concentrate on navigating the airplane on the taxiways and not hitting other airplanes and stuff, and not be occupied with doing tasks such as cleaning up the airplane. But that's just a guess. I don't know. It's not the way we do it at ACME. We're supposed to retract the flaps and get the airplane all cleaned up before we arrive at the gate. Thanks, Jack, for sending your feedback. I appreciate it. Let's see, how long have we been going here since I started part two? Oh, about an hour and a half, and we already have another 45. So I'm going to try to knock out a few more here before I call it quits, okay? Another 14-year-old, James, writes, I'm a 14-year-old that wants to get into flying. I have a few questions for you. Is an aircraft able to take off without flaps? Yes. And I wrote him back and answered his other two questions as well, which I have answered in the past, and so I'm not going to belabor you listeners with answering those questions again. But I will answer James' first question regarding, can an airplane take off without flaps? As long as you have a long enough runway and you can get enough speed, sure, you can fly, because the airplane wing was designed to fly at higher speeds without putting flaps out to change the shape of the wing to fly at lower speeds. So, but the reason why we use flaps for takeoff and landing is that we change the shape of the wing, which provides more lift at a lower speed, and so going down the runway, we're going to be at a lower speed than we would be up at cruise altitude. And so we put those flaps out to help us. Now you'd think, well, wouldn't the flaps out, you know, cause more drag? Yeah, it does cause a little bit more parasite and induced drag, but the increase in lift more than offsets the increase in drag. So it's a better situation for most scenarios. Now, at Acme, we've been doing something for the last year or so called flex flap takeoffs. And, you know, it used to be that there was always a standard setting for the flaps for takeoff, and you'd never see any other setting. But the engineers have gone through and said, you know, if you took off instead of using 11 degrees of flaps, you only used 5 degrees of flaps. Yes, it results in a longer roll for takeoff, but if you have the runway length to do it and the atmospheric conditions are appropriate, it will save some fuel. And so we've been seeing a lot more of these flexible flap takeoffs at Acme in the last year or so. There are also other times where you actually extend the flaps even more than you would for a normal takeoff. For instance, flying out of LaGuardia, if you're heavy and it's hot, or Washington National, you have a relatively short runway to use to get the airplane airborne. And so sometimes instead of using 11 flaps, we'll use flaps 18. So they're even hanging out further than they normally do. And in that case, uses less runway. And so there are lots of different reasons to use different flap settings, as long as you have the performance necessary to do it safely. So getting back to your initial question, is it possible for an airplane to take off without flaps? As long as you know that that's what your intent is, and you have a long enough runway to get enough speed to do it, yes. But in practice, you hardly ever see that. I'm sure there are some exceptions to that general rule, but almost every transport category airplane that I can think of out there use the slats, which are the leading edge devices that extend downward and again change the shape of the wing in the front part of the wing, and flaps that change the camber and cord of the wing in the back, changing the shape of the wing and creating more lift. So I thought that was going to be a short answer, but it never turns out to be a short answer when I'm talking. So thanks, James. Okay, Frick again says, when Irish eyes are smiling, sure 'tis like the morning spring, but erratic roster planning, Aer Lingus to a standstill a union bring. 700 to 800 crew decided to stop. They all reckon that roster planning is a flop. The management disagree. Most favorable conditions they decree. Okay, enough silliness. Here's the link to the article, and he gives me a link to this article that says, up to 800 Aer Lingus cabin crew protest in Dublin. And this was just a few days ago, last week, last Friday. And they did a 24-hour stoppage, Aer Lingus did, at the Dublin airport on Friday, hit over 200 flights, and affected the travel plans of some 30,000 people. Wow. And apparently the union said that they don't like the roster. They want to change to the rosters or schedules that they have. The company is saying that its cabin crew enjoy some of the most favorable working conditions in Ireland. But the union member said that its members were engaged in the industrial action because our experience has been that our employer won't listen to us. Quote, for 3 years we have raised concerns about the erratic nature of our rosters. We have become accustomed to the chaotic work patterns that are our direct product of those rosters, to the point where we understand the detrimental effect they're having on cabin crew and the corrosive effect they're having on the airline too. The cabin crew are asking the company to introduce a fixed roster involving 5 days working to be followed by 3 days off. This is a similar arrangement that's already in place for the pilots at Aer Lingus. The cabin crew have argued that current roster arrangements are erratic and impose excessive fatigue. And the Aer Lingus management has said that this would be would significantly increase costs. So again, the union says, our members are not seeking extra leave. They are quite prepared to work to the demands of the schedule, but they need to have adequate periods of rest between blocks of duty. This would put an end to the chaotic roster patterns currently in use and make the rosters more sustainable. So that is the news about the Aer Lingus cabin crew strike, and they said that they're going to be doing it again sometime soon. So hopefully they'll get together and talk and maybe iron out the situation. Let's see. Neville writes, hope you're well. Just took a look at this Aer Lingus incident and wondered what your take was on it. And so he sends me a link, and I'll put a link in the show notes to this report. Sorry, the sound that I'm making is actually the leather-covered or simulated leather-covered seat that I'm sitting in. Just had to shift a little bit. This was an Airbus A320 that experienced an event. They were, I'm not going to do the whole thing here, but basically they were descending. They were given a descent clearance, and the mistake was made that when they read back the clearance, either they read the clearance back incorrectly and it was not caught either by the controller nor the other pilot or what, but the clearance that they were given was to flight level 340, and they were descending out of a higher altitude to flight level 340. They were told to expect to cross another waypoint or intersection at a much lower altitude of flight level 200. And I believe they read it back correctly, but the pilot monitoring reached up and put in, instead of putting in flight level 340, they put in 240. At some point, as they're approaching this, approaching flight level 340, one of the pilot's questions was, is that right? 240? We're cleared to flight level 240 or 340? So they inquire with air traffic control, and the air traffic control comes back and says, no, you're cleared to flight level 340, not flight level 240. And so apparently the pilot flying tried to make some kind of an automation mode change that did not, either was not the appropriate mode change or didn't have the desired effect. And then as they were approaching rapidly flight level 340 to prevent an altitude bust, the pilot flying disconnected the autoflight system and introduced a movement on the side stick controller to arrest the rate of descent to level off. And apparently it was a little bit too abrupt and injured, I think, two crew members or one crew member and, let's see, only one crew member, actually. One of the flight attendants broke an ankle. So it was pretty significant. I think the G-forces experienced were as much as 2-point-something Gs. Again, I forgot exactly what the G-forces were, but it was significant. And, of course, the flight attendant that experienced the broken ankle was in the back of the airplane, where you're going to feel the most exaggerated effect of an abrupt change in pitch on an airplane. And so it's an interesting report. I'm not sure that the lack of manual flying skills directly impacted this particular event. I think it was more of a thing where, oh, the airplane's not doing what I want it to do, so I'm going to take positive control of the airplane. And maybe it was such an urgent maneuver that the pilot flying just overreacted and put in too large of an input. And so it's an interesting report, so I'll include it in the show notes if you want to take a look at that. So thank you, Neville, for giving me something good to read. But I don't know if I can directly say, well, it's because these Airbus pilots aren't manually flying the airplane. So, but, you know, that might have something, a small amount to do with it, but I have a feeling, again, it was more of the nature of the event and everything happening at the last moment. And I've seen this before. It's easy to overreact when you realize you're about to bust an altitude, which means that you might be, you know, getting violated, and you don't want that to happen. So you do whatever you can to smoothly and safely level off the airplane without busting your altitude. And in this case, I guess it was a little bit too much for the cabin crew. Let's see, Georg writes, I recently discovered this video about the MD-80 on YouTube at the 9.5 minute mark. It is mentioned that the MD-80 has 40 different dimmers for the cockpit lighting. How many of those dimmers do you typically use? all 40 or just a small subset. So I'm in the airplane today, Georg, and it's dark this morning because we had a 5:55 departure out of Dallas-Fort Worth. And even this time of year, it's still very dark before 6 o'clock. And so we were adjusting our cockpit lighting. And I started to pay attention to how many different knobs I was actuating and switches, etc., to acclimate the lighting to the low light situation. And I realized that although I did not count 40, I'm sure that 40 is probably a reasonable number for the MD-80. I think some of those in that group of 40 dimmers are automatic systems that have like little light meters that determine how much lighting is there and automatically adjust the brightness of the instrument display. I know we have some of those. The flat panel that displays all the engine parameters are one of those. But then we have a bunch of other knobs that you actually have to turn to adjust the brightness control. And surprisingly, there are a bunch of them. And it's just gotten to the point where I'm so used to making all those adjustments, you almost don't think about how many different little things you're actuating and moving to adjust the lighting. And so very interesting. Yeah, I'd say that we use transitioning from darkness to lightness and lightness to darkness. We typically use most of those 40 different dimmers, I would say, except for those that are dimming the lighting automatically. So I'll include a link to that. It's probably the one that a lot of people have seen talking about the American Airlines pilot that flies the MD-80. I'm not sure, though. I don't think I actually looked at the video, Georg, but I'll include that in the show notes. Oh, we're getting there, folks. But again, it's going to be one of those situations where I'm not going to get to all of your feedback on this episode. But I'm trying. Alex chimed in on the chatter versus the Boeing 737 versus Airbus A320 nacelle differences. Based on some time I spent with an engine manufacturer, the rumor was that the nacelle had to be redesigned for the Boeing 73, as the ground clearance of the aircraft is much lower than the Airbus. As a result, you get this squashed look that you referenced. Yeah, I think I mentioned that. But in this case, I think that it had more to do with the different engine manufacturer, Pratt & Whitney versus Rolls-Royce or GE. Thanks, Alex. Joe writes, beginner, I'm 17 years old, and I'm in the UK, and I want to be a pilot. He is currently doing his private pilot license at the British Airways Flying Club. What advice can you give for a 17-year-old trying to get into flying? In school, do the best you can. Make as high grades as possible. When you're getting flight instruction for your private pilot license, try to pay attention as much as you can. Enjoy it as much as you can. Remember these times, because when you become an old fart like myself, you won't remember very much. So try to make that something that's really making an indelible mark in your brain right now, so that when you're 55 years old and after flying commercial airliners for many, many years, you'll remember these days, Joe, when you're 17, learning how to fly and getting your private pilot's license. Listen to your instructor. If you don't have a good rapport with your instructor, then find another one. It's not worth enduring a personality conflict or a style that doesn't result in the optimum performance for you. Those are just some of the things that I can think of off the top of my head. Do everything to the best of your ability. Listen to as much advice as you can from others, and do as well as you can in school. And listen to your mom and dad, because they brought you into this world and they love you very much, speaking as a parent. Thanks, Joe. Fernando says, I'm a private pilot working towards the IFR and CPL. Your podcast makes my day at work so much easier. Great show. Thank you, and God bless. You're welcome, Fernando. Thanks for giving me that positive encouragement. I do appreciate it. Let's see. Shall we go a little bit more Yeah, it's going to be one of those long episodes. Yeah, we're going to do it. I'm going to play one more piece of audio feedback, and then I'm going to have to call it quits, okay? So let's listen to Christopher, who is a blind pilot or a blind person from Australia. So take it away, Christopher.
Hello, Captain Jeff. My name is Christopher. I'm talking to you from Melbourne, Australia. Now, I very much enjoy your podcast, and to that end, I wish to thank you for such. I am a totally blind aviation enthusiast who very much enjoys anything to do with aviation, but particularly enjoy listening to Live ATC, the Melbourne feed. I don't know if you've ever had the chance to come down under, but Australia has two air traffic centres, as opposed to, I don't know how many en route centres you have over in the States, but you have a fair few, I know that. We have two. One serving the southern part of the country, and the other basically from New Zealand up to the Great Australian Bight, and then anywhere north of that is served by Brisbane Centre. Melbourne also appears to be the, well, we appear to be the corporate jet capital of at least the southern part of the country anyway, based on the number of such movements I hear coming out of Essendon Airport. The other interesting thing about Australian flying is it's probably most flying that you do around here. If you're landing in on a country airstrip, the chances are that you do not have the luxury of a control tower, and you are doing. There are lots of CTAF procedures that you're doing. 1267 is the very much you get to very used to using it over here. Anyway, I just thought I would leave you this piece of feedback, and wishing you clear skies, tailwinds, and I will speak to you at some other time.
I hope so, Christopher. Thank you very much for your audio feedback. Excellent, excellent. And I'm glad to hear that somebody, a blind aviation enthusiast, down under, I know I don't do well with accents, down under, is listening to me. And you mentioned listening to Live ATC and the audio that they have there. And that reminds me of Carl sent me some feedback, and he said, hey, here, let me just quickly pull that up, since it kind of, the Live ATC thing that you mentioned, Christopher, reminded me of Carl's feedback as well. He says, I've been listening to Live ATC, both through your podcast and the app. While listening, there seems to be quite a bit of static in the communication at times. The static can make a difficult task out of understanding the conversation. Do you ever find it hard to understand what someone is saying on the radio, or is what I'm hearing just a poor recording from Live ATC? Thanks for the podcast and keep up the great work. Well, if you look at Live ATC and their website, they kind of explain the technology they're using to get all these recorded audio feeds and archive the information there. And most of them are from people who are volunteers, or aviation enthusiasts themselves, and have set up scanners to record these conversations. And it's based on the equipment they have, the position of the equipment, and how many frequencies they're scanning, etc. And sometimes some of the communications, the radio frequencies that they're actually picking up and recording, are not at their optimum distance or whatever quality and signal strength, et cetera. And so sometimes you hear all that static and it's really hard to understand, even for somebody like me who kind of knows what people are likely to say. But I think that that's just one of the inherent difficulties with having an all-volunteer system, and they're doing the best they can with the equipment that they have. And I think they're doing a fantastic job. But as far as your question is that the way it really is when you're up there flying around in your jet on ACME flight so-and-so? I mean, is there a lot of static? And no, very, very rarely do you get to the point where the radio communication is not clear, loud and clear. Sometimes if an air traffic control sector controller forgets to hand you off to the next sector and you might be getting close to the range of that particular antenna that they have selected to communicate with you, you might start getting a situation where it's getting really kind of staticky and you're realizing, oop, we need to change to the next frequency. And then you can report that to air traffic control and they'll say, oh, okay, well, switch to me on this frequency or contact the next sector controller on this frequency. And then communication gets back to 5x5. Which means loud and clear. So I'd say 99% of the time, the communications that we hear on our radios are, really, really good. And there's no static or mistaking what people are saying to you. So, which is the way it should be, right? Because it's important for safety. But yeah, the stuff that you're hearing on a liveatc.net, sometimes it's really, really great and clear because they have the scanner like right next to the airport, and it can pick up a lot of these things very, very clearly. Other times, they're in suboptimal positions and locations where they're just not able to pick up the communications that well. So, again, I love liveatc.net, and I love all of you out there, Carl and Christopher and everybody else that has taken the time to listen to the show and send me feedback. Again, Christopher, down under, thank you for taking the time to record, and I hope that you do follow up on your promise that you'll send more feedback in the future. And yeah, looks like I have several more that I didn't get to again, but I really do need to go for physiological reasons, for I need to study for my training, which is going to be day after tomorrow, Friday night and Saturday night, and I need to get ready for meeting up with some of you out there who happen to be here in the Cleveland area, and we're going to meet and we're going to talk aviation. Should be a lot of fun. Again, check out, hopefully I'll have something there to check out, airlinepilotguy.com/live, where hopefully the recording from our meetup will be there. You can kind of get a feel for what it might be like to show up for a meetup sometime. So again, airlinepilotguy.com, the place to find out about all the different places you can listen to the show. And iTunes, of course, the biggest one for the audio downloads. And YouTube, if you want to see what Captain Jeff looks like while he's recording his audio show, you can head over to YouTube. My YouTube channel is Airline Pilot Guy. And what else? Yeah, that's all I can think of at this moment. So I'll go ahead and send you off, and hope that you have a great weekend, a great week. Hope to be back again next week for episode 121. In the meantime, wishing you clear skies, unlimited visibility, and tailwinds. Take care and God bless.
Good day.